sisters that are here. Amen. He's just a great God, and this is my first time to the, this is the North Central, what is this? I'm trying to remember how I said it on the radio. It's a whole lot of stuff. But I'm happy to be here today. And he's a good God. Now, you don't have to turn it up. I'm going to work it from here. Just leave it right there. Right there. I'll do all I need to do here. You can get your Bible because it ain't going to change. Let's go to the Word of God today. Go to Joshua, the 5th chapter. Joshua, the 5th chapter. Songs to me come in seasons. And the song that I'm kind of stuck on right now says this. It won't always be like this. The Lord will perfect that concerning me. Sooner or later, turns in my favor. It's turning around for me. Oh, Lord, have mercy. It's turning around for me. See, it won't always be like this. The Lord will perfect that concerning me. And sooner or later, it turns in my favor. It's turning around for me. I don't know what it's doing for you. Joshua 5, I want to read. I want to skip around, if you'll allow me to do so. If you have Joshua 5 and 1, indicate by shouting amen. Hear the beginning of the reading of God's word. And it came to pass that when all the kings of the Amorites, which were on the side of Jordan westward, and all the kings of the Canaanites, which were by the sea, heard that the Lord had dried up the waters of Jordan from before the children of Israel until we were passed over, Lord have mercy, that their heart melted, neither was their spirit in them anymore because of the children of Israel. At that time the Lord said unto Joshua, make thee sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time. And Joshua made him sharp knives and circumcised the children of Israel at the heel of foreskins. And this is the cause why Joshua did circumcise all the people that came out of Egypt that were males, even all the men of war died wilderness, by the way, after they came out of Egypt. Now, all the people that came out were circumcised, but all the people that were born in the wilderness, by the way, as they came forth out of Egypt, them, they had not circumcised. You need to note that. For the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people that were men of war, which came out of Egypt, were consumed because they obeyed not the voice of the Lord. whom the Lord sware that he would not show them the land which the Lord sware unto their fathers, that he would give us a land that floweth with milk and honey. The ninth verse. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off of you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day. Our subject is derived from that ninth verse. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off of you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day. Grab your neighbor by the hand, look them in the eye, and repeat the words of our subject. Say, neighbor, it's off me. Yeah. I need somebody to help me preach tonight. Yeah, I got one. Look at your neighbor and say with prophetic enthusiasm, say, neighbor, it's off me. Yes. It won't always be like this. That's such a powerful line. This is a pivotal point in Joshua's leadership, and I think it is pivotal in yours as well. Let us carefully and exegetically look at this entire chapter. Verse 1, we see that all of the enemies of Israel westward of Jordan are scared because the Jordan dried up before them. Point number one. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is point number one. Yeah, we got about four, but we're going to deal with the first one. This point number one. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is point number one. Tell them you made it. That's the first point. That's the first point. First point is that you made it. Going forward, you should have an indomitable, and that word means that it cannot be subdued or overcome. It's not conquerable. It's unconquerable. So you should have an indomitable spirit. What amazes me is that we get saved and so soon forget what God brought us through. We become so passive. Oh, Jesus. You know, we just, I can't preach like I want to preach. No. Some things I used to be able to say, I can't say. But it is so amazing how when we were in the world, we went to parties with people we know didn't like us. We trying to get the same girl or after the same man. And it didn't make any difference. Folk could cuss you out and you still were showing up. You was broke, you was drunk, you was high, you was still going though. And when it come to church, we let the ushers stop us from coming to church. They roll their eyes at me. Are you kidding me? this deacon don't like. Well, it didn't stop you. You knew they wasn't like. You went there knowing they didn't like you. And out of all you've been through, you should not allow anything to make you think you can't get over it. You should have an indomitable spirit, for if what you just came through could not destroy you, nothing will. Water is symbolic of a few things in Scripture, and one of those things is people. When you read in the Scriptures and he talks about waters, many waters, it is symbolic of people. And the biggest problem you will ever have in doing anything for God is people.
Well, some of them are.
David said it this way. He said, Lord, deliver me from the strivings of the people. Because if I can ever get over what the people think and what the people say, then I can make it. I can do it. This is the reason, one of the things he told Jeremiah. He said, listen, don't even look at their faces, because their faces will cause you to melt. Yeah, when I'm looking at y'all, I'm not looking at y'all, I'm looking above your heads, because to stare at y'all would make me stop preaching. If you can ever get over the opinions of people, then you can. Now that's easier said than done. Because a lot of us live for folk to like us. And mother, if you ever get past the place where you're unconcerned whether they like you or not, you become a dangerous man. You become a dangerous individual. Because people want folk to like them. And that's okay. But somehow God has to deliver you that, deliver you from that, because if you live for the adulation of the people, then you'll find yourself compromising what God has called you to do so that they can continue to applaud you. Sometimes God's going to tell you to say some things they don't want to hear. I don't hear nobody talking to me. And so let's look at the text. Let's look at the text. The text says that they have just spent 40 years in a wilderness. And then overnight, God tells them to get up and we're going over this Jordan. They get across the Jordan in a miraculous fashion. And that's the reason I have to be careful and pace myself, because I really do get excited when I preach, simply because I'm included in the text. I'm preaching to you, but I'm also preaching to me. And what I understand is that where I am now, based on what they had to say, I should not have made it over. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but do I have anybody here that, based on what they said, they thought that last situation was gonna knock you out of the game? But here you come, and not only did you get over, but you got over in miraculous fashion. That thing that kept you separated from what God had promised you, you walked over on dry land. And not only did you walk over, but you took up some stones while you were going across, so that your children could recognize, if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side. Lord, help me here. Tell somebody, I made it over. I made it over. And because I made it, because you made it, your very appearance frightens folk. When you show up, they get nervous.
because they threw their best shot and you bounce back. Lord have mercy. They thought that they, I wish I could find my hearer here. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That the devil, I want you to understand, stop acting like, well, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it. Oh, you meant it. Look at your name and say, you meant it. You meant it. You absolutely meant it. I'm tired of folk acting like it was a Freudian slip. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. That wasn't no slip. You meant to hurt my feelings. You meant to destroy me. You meant to kill me. You set out all those things about me because you thought it would stop me. But God brought me through all of that. And when I show up, tell your neighbor, you ought to get nervous. You ought to get nervous. Every time you see me walking, you ought to get nervous, because you had no intention for me to come out of what I've been in. But God was on my side. Let me slow myself down. Touch somebody and tell them God was on my side. Forty years. Folks were hoping that you would quit. 40 years, people waiting on you to give up. 40 years, people counting you out. But look at you. You showed up anyhow. I know I got the right message. I just wonder if I'm in the right place. Look at your neighbor and say, I showed up anyhow. They didn't want me to come. They thought I was done. They called it over. They had the ashes and dust to dust. They threw dirt on top of me. But look at God. God brought me through. Look at your neighbor and say, I look pretty good too. I look. For the years, people have been waiting and hoping that you would give up, give in, or at the very least be controlled or overwhelmed by their opinion of you. But you made it, you made it. And now that you're on this side of Jordan, never again allow the opinion of others to deter you from going after what God says is yours. It is at this time that you are ready to hear from God. This is really important. This is really important. You remember when they had just come out of Egypt. They went into the wilderness. And while they were in the wilderness, God told Moses to come up into the mountain. Moses goes up into the mountain, and while he's up there receiving instruction from God, they fall back into their Egyptian worship. And they get a calf and run around the calf. Moses is in an intense meeting with God. And God interrupts the meeting and says, Mo, I need you to go down there and talk to your people that you brought out. He says, I know them, and they are rebellious and stiff-necked. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to let me kill them. And I will raise you up a people that will obey. I don't hear nobody talking to me now. And Moses says, God, don't do that. Because what the Egyptians will say is that you were able to get them out of Egypt, but you weren't able to get them into the promised land. And I don't want you to look bad. Well, let me fast forward. God eventually ended up killing all of them that came out. And Moses didn't make it to the promised land, because God knows And hence the reason for Joshua's success as an administrator is that he said, I ain't gonna be like Moses. I let God kill all y'all. As a matter of fact, y'all got to choose who y'all gonna serve. If you wanna go back now. But as for me and my house and everybody that's hanging with me, we gonna serve the Lord. He said, gotcha, Josh, we got you. We gonna serve it. But now the point is, if we look from the perspective of Moses, Moses was concerned about how folk looked at God. Lord, have mercy. And what you have to understand is that your life speaks of your God. I wish I had time to take you point by point. I don't want to. When we say God is able, there must be evidences in our life to prove that he's able. This is not Aesop's fable. This is not Mother Goose. This is not a fictional novel. This is the truth of God's word. And everything that God says, he has to perform. God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Hath he not said it, and will he not do it? Hath he not spoken, and will he not make it good? You have to understand that God's words are creative forces. As soon as he says it, it happens. Lord have mercy. It may not manifest in the natural, but it's already done. Look at your neighbor and say, it's already done. I really don't have time. This is something that needs to be taught. All right, let me move on. I'm the guest speaker for tonight. So Moses goes down with the people not knowing the only reason they're still alive is because he saved their lives. They still don't get it. Still don't get it. And God brings them through, and God proclaims while they're in the wilderness that everyone 20 years and older will not go into the promised land, but everyone 20 years and younger will go into the promised land. They had just been out of Egypt a little over a month, and they had doubted God a bunch of times, and they just got out. I don't know why we have selective amnesia. Why we can't remember from day to day what God has done for us. Ooh, Lord, help me preach this. Thank you, Jesus. All right, I'm trying to be nice. So y'all need to say amen so I can get through this. Thank you, Jesus. So God says, since they have tempted me these 10 times in the wilderness, I am going to make every day a year. They've just been out 40 days, but they're going to stay here 40 years. Tell your neighbor, point number two, the covenant, say covenant, must accompany consecration. Covenant must accompany consecration. The purpose of the fast, the Bible says that fasting, we humble ourselves through fasting and prayer. You have to recognize that being saved is a fight. I really was looking for some amens. I thought, anybody saved here? I said, being saved is a fight. Yeah. If you're not fighting, you ain't saved. He that liveth godly must suffer persecution. Would y'all say, I thought this was a sanctified church. See, the problem with the 21st century church is that we don't understand living holy. We talk holy, we know all the right verses, but we don't practice holiness. I ain't getting too much amens here. And how do you know you're living holy? Well, the way you know you're living holy is because there's a fight going on in your flesh. I said there's a fight going on in your flesh. The Apostle Paul said it this way: when I will to do good, evil was present. And the very thing that I said I wouldn't do, that's what I found myself doing. And the thing that I said I would do, I couldn't find a way to accomplish it. And he said, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ. And then he walks on into the seventh chapter and says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Watch this, who walk not. Oh, look at your neighbor and say, you got to walk this out. You got to walk this out. Said you got to walk this out. Church is so squirmish. I ain't trying to get on nobody's nerve. I'm just preaching. I'm going home. But the point I need to make is the church is so pathetic. Not here, but certainly other places is so pathetic. We're trying to figure out if same-sex marriages is something that we can do. What you trying to figure out? So now they have all these types of tests and things going on. Well, maybe they could have been born like that. Well, if you were born like that, although they don't have any anatomical proof that you could be born like that, but if you were, you must be born. Okay. Lord, help me tonight. So let me be nice. Let me be nice. So if you are struggling in the area of your sexuality, it be it heterosexual, because fornication is still wrong. Y'all do know that. You do know adultery is still wrong. I don't hear nobody talking to me like I need you to talk to me. So whether heterosexual, homosexual, if you do not understand that it's wrong, if there is a fight in your flesh, whether it's for drinking, smoking, whatever, lotto tickets, playing the numbers, going to the casino. I know y'all want me to hurry up and go home. Whatever the fight is, the reason you know you're saved is because you're fighting. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm fighting, but I'm winning. Lord, have mercy. Is this too terrible for me to preach? Let's look at the text, and I'm going to let you go. Let's look at the text. Let's go inside the text, because it's very possible to go to church and not keep the covenant. Very possible to look like you got him and not keep the covenant. Here's the problem.
The problem is, if you always have to look back to prove God was with you, not when he's a very present,
I remember when he brought us out. I remember when he did it. What are you doing now? Now let's look at the text. I'm trying to get.
The reason Israel is in this predicament is because obviously they copped an attitude with God.
Don't you sit there with that pious look. Because we often cop an attitude with God. Let me tell you how we cop an attitude with God. We cop an attitude with God when the promise of God is not fulfilled within the time constraints that we give him.
When we come out and we say, God's going to hear me. God's going to hear me. God's going to save my husband. God's going to save my children. God's going to give me $1 million. And I know I heard from him. And then when it don't happen within the time constraints, then we get an attitude with God. Not recognizing we held it up. Now, I'm not going to go into all that because I know y'all want to get out of here real quick. So let me just trust me when I tell you, we cop an attitude with God.
How did they cop an attitude? How do you know they copped an attitude? Because God was very clear. He was very clear all the way back there with Abram. He told Abram, this is the token of the covenant. Every male after the eighth day has to be circumcised in the foreskin. Now, if you do it on the eighth day, baby ain't gonna have no memory. It's gonna hurt, but he ain't gonna have no memory. He ain't gonna know. He's gonna cry anyway. He don't know why he's crying.
Ishmael was about 12 years old when Abram had to circumcise him. All of the servants of Abram had to be circumcised. Abram had to be circumcised because that was the token of the covenant. And so through the historicity of Israel, they understood this is what we do. This is the promise that Father Abraham made with God. And we have to keep the covenant. And it was kept until God told them they had to stay in the wilderness. Now, the text clearly says that all of the men that came out of Egypt were circumcised. But nobody in the wilderness got circumcised. Because we cop an attitude with God. Lord, I feel like preaching now, so y'all ain't got to say nothing. How dare you say to your children, well, you know, my mama made me come to church, and I don't want to make my children come to church. I want them to choose whether or not. So I asked them on Sunday morning, should they come? And if they don't feel like it, I understand. Are you kidding me? I wish I might have had a choice whether or not I was coming to church. That choice didn't exist. If I had the chicken pox or if it was snowing, we still couldn't go outside because they taught us to remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. I don't feel nobody in here. You got to recognize that your children will be the sum total of what you teach them.
problem is we're allowing the world to teach our children. I was in Savannah last night and I told them that the problem is the devil had to figure out how to lessen the impact of a parent in the life of their child. And they did it by a telephone. What's your 12-year-old need with her own phone? All right, I know I'm losing my focus. My son come telling me, he said, "Dad, I need a phone." I said, "No, what you need is a job." When he got a phone, he was working. Now, why is that so important? It's because they have access to your child when you don't have access. Sitting up in the phone, turning on pornographic sites, listening to all kinds of nonsense, and you don't have nothing to say with it, and you're wondering why they're acting funny, talking funny, and disobedient, because that's what's going down in their spirit. Y'all don't have to like me tonight. You cop an attitude with God, and your children end up suffering. These children, the pain that they're getting ready to experience should have been over by now. But the children of Israel said, "We ain't going in, so we're not going to keep the covenant.
Lord have mercy.
We're not going in. We're going to be here 40 days, so I'm not circumcising my child." The covenant must be kept. And so all while they're in the wilderness, even though God is feeding them miraculously every day, they're carrying a reproach. Because nobody has thought we need to do something about this. And you can look at me with that smug look, but I want you to understand, think back in your own history. Think about your own situation. When you get sick of God, or when God doesn't do what you want him to do when you think he ought to do it, then that's when you get scarce around church. That's when you have the nerve to talk about, I'm a little discouraged, and I don't feel like coming to church. And, you know, I'm a little disappointed with God. And, hey, pray for me. Pray. That the whole thing. Y'all pray for me because I'm offended. God didn't do what I want. Hey. I realize he's got. And I'm going to be okay. But y'all just pray for me. And then that one day turns into 2 weeks. And the 2 weeks turn into 6 months. And the 6 months come. And where you going? Look, I don't say I ain't saved because I ain't been to church. God is with me everywhere. No, he ain't with you. Because you're not keeping the covenant. Look at your neighbor and say, "You ain't keeping no covenant." I was glad when they said. When you get discouraged and you begin to back down from the things you know to do, that proves that you have lost faith in your God. And it's very possible to cop an attitude with God. You're not the only one that did it. You're not the only one that did it. Elijah did it. Called fire down from heaven. And then quit. Set up on the juniper tree and said, "It's enough. I'm going to die." Requested for God to kill him. And when God showed up, he said, "What you doing here? Did I tell you to come here?" God was so kind that he baked him a cake. He went on the strength of that cake for 40 days. Lord have mercy. You're not the only one to cop an attitude with God. Jeremiah copped an attitude with God. He said, "I'm tired of it. God, your call to me was a derision. It didn't work out the way I thought it should have worked out. So I quit." And the Bible says he went home and sat out and said, "I'm not going to prophesy anymore. I'm not going to preach anymore." But the problem is when you get called of God, when you let his word go down on the inside. I need to talk to some people that thought about it, but look at your neighbor and say, "I can't quit. I can't quit. I've been hurt enough to quit, but I can't quit." Because there's something on the inside of me. He said, "And I thought
on the word of God. And when I mused on it, it was like fire. What God has promised you, what God has told you. Look at your neighbor and say, it's still alive. It's still alive. And the predicament I'm in is because I copped an attitude with God. But I'm getting ready to make it better. What you have to learn is that the earlier you make the commitment and keep it, the better off you'll be. It'll be less painful. See, what I try to tell people is that if you quit God, in order for you to be saved, you're going to have to come back to Him. So why even quit? So now they're in the wilderness, and God has moved them until they get across the Jordan. But He says, for us to go any further, we have to recommit to the covenant. So I try to tell people, if you can't progress, don't regress, just recess. If you can't go forward, don't go backward, just... Because they that wait on the Lord... Hold on, I'm just about there. I'm not through. I'm just going to cut across the field. But now they have to go back and do what should have been done 40 years ago. Thank you, Jesus. I know the thoughts that I think towards you, that they're thoughts of good, they're thoughts of peace, and not of evil. To bring you to an expected end. I know what I'm going to do for you, with you, and through you. It has not changed. But before we go another further, I need you to recommit to the covenant. And I know it's going to hurt now, because you've gotten attached to some things that you got to let go. I know it's going to be a little bit more painful now, because you've grown attached to some things that you should not have ever grown attached to. See, Jesus said, if any man come after me, let him first deny himself. To walk through the sword of self-denial is the first step you ought to take. And when you take that first step, you recognize that nothing else really matters. If we look at the hyperbole of Scripture and check out the symbolic of Abraham's children, we recognize that Ishmael was a child of the flesh, and Isaac was a child of the spirit. And the two things I want to say is that Abraham loved Ishmael, and he was sweet on Hagar. But when God told him he had to give both of them up, he was grieved, but he did it. And it hurt him to do it. But once you give up Ishmael, it's easy to give up Isaac. Lord have mercy. You see, when you recognize that I've already come through some things, and that nothing was able to keep me from the God I loved, then when you run into something else where God asks you to give it up, you say, here, Lord, because I recognize that God has my best
heart. He has my best interest at heart. And God is not going to be any man's debtor. But whatever I give God, he's able to give back to me exceedingly, abundantly, above all that I could ask or imagine. There's nothing that I have that God is not worthy of. But you got to learn how to give up something. And if you learn how to give up that one thing, Jesus looked at the rich young ruler and said, "One thing thou lackest. I need you to sell everything you have and give your profit to the poor. Take up your cross and follow me." And the Bible says the boy walked away grieved because he was more in love with his stuff than he was with his calling. And once you recognize that what God has for you is greater than anything you can give up, then whatever God asks for, you start throwing it at him. Because whatever you give up, you can ask God to give it back, and God will do exactly. I wish I had somebody here that recognized that it's time to give up some stuff. I know you're gonna cry about it. Look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, give it up anyhow. I know it's gonna hurt you, but give it up anyhow. I know people gonna talk about you, but give it up anyhow. I know people gonna say you're crazy, but give it up anyhow, because they can't see what God has in your future. God's gonna give you greater than whatever you gave up. If you believe it, shout glory."
Please be seated. I didn't mean to get that excited. So now they're getting ready to go and take the promised land 40 years later. But they have to make the commitment. Every day that they spent in Egypt was a reproach to the nation. Every day you live outside of the promises of God is a reproach to the God you serve. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure. Having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. And let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Lord, have mercy. Every day that you live in sin, it's a reproach to what God has called you to be. Every day you say God's not able to deliver, it's a reproach to what God has called you to be. Every day you give, I'm a preacher, somebody come out of sin tonight. Every day that you say you don't have the power to overcome your urges is a day you live in reproach. Every day you find yourself tipping and slipping and dipping is a day you live in reproach, because God said, "Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and I will receive you unto myself, and you'll be my people, and I'll be your God." Lord, have mercy. I want you to understand that the promises of God are predicated on your obedience to God. Therefore, dearly beloved, having received the promises of God, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. That's what Corinthians says. Look at your neighbor and say, "Neighbor, it's coming off me tonight."
Not only does God want you to feel the pain, but he wants you to experience the healing. Lord, have mercy. Tell your neighbor, continue in the camp. Say, continue in the camp until you're made whole. What happened, the Bible says, is that night the men cried and they were weak. And even though God had told them to go toward Jericho, they had to stay there until they were made whole. Most times when people are hurt or offended, they have a tendency to leave. And in a lot of cases, that's why they can't do anything. The reason is because hurt people hurt people. And when you carry your hurt from one camp to the next, all you can talk about is how you were done wrong. And even though folk follow you, you find yourself in a situation where you got a whole lot of mad black folk. You got a whole lot of hurt folk. And because you walk around hurt, because you walk around offended, that's all they know. But you got to recognize that you got to let it go. Tell your neighbor, let it go. Yes, sir. Being mad at that sister is old now. It's been 3 years you haven't talked. Tell your neighbor, let it go. Some of you tonight need to go home and make some phone calls because you need to let that stuff go. You need to stop talking about it because they're not in your future no how, and you're allowing your past to stymie your progress. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, let it go. Lord, have mercy. You don't even need to write a book about it. You need to just let that go. Lord, have mercy. And the only way for God to begin the healing process is you have to forgive. You have to learn how to let it go. You can sit there and say, I forgave him, but I didn't forget it. Well, then you really didn't forget it. And you really didn't forgive him. Because to forgive is to forget. As a matter of fact, when you see him, it don't even pop up in your mind. That's how you know you've been set free. Lord, have mercy. Yes, sir. You got to learn how to let it go. You got to learn how when folk are trying to kill you, know that all things work together for good to them that love God and for those that are the called according to his purpose. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, let it go. If God put you in a situation, it's because he's trying to get some stuff out of you and put some stuff in you. Lord, have mercy. And you can't talk about your enemy. You gotta love your enemy. Even when you know they're turning on you, you got to look at them and call them friend. I don't hear nobody talking to me. Shout at your neighbor, say, neighbor, let them go. When you let it go, when you forgive, then the healing particles of the Holy Spirit can begin to make you whole. But you gotta stay in the camp until you're completely cured. God has enough grace to wait. I'm gonna say that again. I said God has enough grace to wait. He's got enough grace to wait for you to become whole, for you to become cured. It's not that. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, it ain't going nowhere. If he waited 40 years, he can wait 3 more days. If he waited for you to get over this, he can wait for you to be healed from it. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, let the Holy Ghost make you whole. Now let me close and I'm finished. In Arabic, reproach means, or is the word, kerpa, which means contemptuous treatment, insult, a condition of shame, to taunt and to scorn. Gilgal is an interesting place for this to take place, because what Gilgal means is a wheel rolling. And it actually means that the wheel is moving. Sometimes we say, God, it seems like you're a bit unfair, because I'm the one that did everything you told me to do. And it seems like I'm the one that's being held back. God seemed like the person that's doing the most wrong seems to be getting away. And you actually want me to forgive them. Yeah. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, this is how we roll. The church has to learn how to forgive. The church has to learn how to love those that hate them. The church has to learn how to forgive them that despitefully use us. The church has to learn how to bless them that curse them. Look at your neighbor and say, that's how we roll. I know it looks like we're weak. I know it looks like we're timid, but what you don't understand is when I'm forgiving you, I'm heaping coals of fire upon your head. Keep laughing at me. Keep making fun of me. You don't recognize my love is either going to draw you or it's going to hurt you. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. I need somebody in here that's ready to stand up for what God has called them to do. Every day, folk will treat you bad. People will talk about you, and folk will lie on you. But what they don't recognize is that I'm rolling it off me. I feel like preaching. I'm going to close now. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't care what you think about me. It's off me today. Thank you, Jesus. You got to learn how to let it go. The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Corinth and says it's a shame that brother is taking brother to court before the unjust judge, not knowing that we gonna judge angels. Tell your neighbor, let it go. As a matter of fact, he said it this way: I'd rather you suffer to be defrauded than to take your brother to court. Why is that necessary? When you're defrauded, it means that you are kept from something that is legally, rightfully, and morally yours. But when you learn how to give it to God, you say, God, I'm casting it upon you, and I'd rather take the hit than to embarrass you. I need somebody that's ready to walk around Jericho, shake your neighbor's hand, and say, neighbor, it's off me. I can't carry all of that stuff into the next spot that God is elevating me to. I feel release in this place. Do I have anybody here that's ready to go to the next dimension? If you're tired of church as usual, if you recognize that God has made you a promise and that it's getting ready to happen, shake yourself and say, it's coming off of me tonight. God is getting ready to roll that thing off. Yes, yes. God is getting ready to strain it all out, but he needs you. He says, when you stand, forgive. You gotta learn before you go to naming it and claiming it. Forgive before you go to grab dabbing it and grabbing it. Forgive before you go to walking on a wall. Forgive because if you can't forgive, God can't bless you. Shake your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor, it's off me. I'm letting it go. I'm letting it go. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I've had in my life some terrible things happen, but I recognize the people that hurt me were not worth my future. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, they're not worth your future. You can keep your attitude, or you can forgive and get on with your life. Get it off you. Yeah. Get it off you. Yeah. Tell your neighbor, get it off you. Go to I'm taking my seat. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I know you've been through some things, but God has brought you this far. And oh, Lord. Hey! Ah, Lord, he didn't bring you this far for you to lose what you have. The promise of God, look at your name and say, it's still good. I know it's been a while, but it's still good. Oh, I know you've been through some things, but it's still good. The reason you know that it's still good, 40 years ago, God brought you out, and the nations on the other side of the flood are still scared of you. Yeah! The Canaanites are still worried. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying when the church stands up and becomes the church, the devil got to run, because if you resist the devil, he's got to flee. All you gotta do, all you gotta do, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's off me. Ah, no. Yeah. Ah, yes. It really is off of me. I need somebody that recognizes that he's the same today, yesterday, and forever. Shake your neighbor's hand. Shake it like you mean it. And say, neighbor, it's all for me. Oh! do you know that it's off of you? Because when it gets off of you, it becomes easy. Woo! When it's off of you, all you gotta do is walk around the problem. You ain't got to say nothing, just walk around it. You know it's off of you, because when you shout, the walls tumble. I wish I had somebody that knew how to praise God with an untethered praise. If you know it's off of you, when I count to three, I want you to throw your head back. Shout like you got it going on. Shout like the enemy is scared. Oh, Lord, I need somebody that's willing to let it go. When I count to three, the world's gonna know. They're gonna say, girl, what happened to you? Boy, you got a new glow. Tell him because it got off of me. I went to a meeting one night. Hey! Are you ready to shout? One, two, three. Lord, the walls are coming down. Yeah, yes, the walls are coming down. Keep on praising them, keep on magnifying them, keep on giving the glory. Shout. Everybody stand to your feet. Week, I had somebody call me like 2 weeks ago from another country because maybe 4 or 5 years early they had done something they knew was wrong, but they, you know, they gave me the obligatory, would you forgive me? But I gave him a real yes. I'm trying not to shout here. They hurt me real bad. They don't recognize folks is real close to you. Cut you real deep. And I didn't have any explanation for why they did what they did. After all I had done for them. And when they family members, it really gets deep. But I knew that they were not worth my future. So they called me a couple of weeks ago. And they said, I just wanted to tell you. They're in another country now. They said, I just wanted to tell you that I'm sorry for what I did. And I said on the other end of the phone, I forgave you the first time. So there's no sense in you calling me, asking me to forgive you again, because I let it go. Let's talk about something else. Because I recognize that what God has for me, I'm not going to let you bind it up. I got to quit now. Grab your neighbor by the hand. And Lord, have mercy. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for deliverance here. I sense in this house tonight that ministries have been tethered because of pain and hurt. But it's coming off of them tonight. In the name of Jesus, I feel the Holy Ghost taking place. Now, what I want you to do is look at your neighbor. And it may not be your neighbor that you need to have in your mind, but that person that you have been holding some ought against. You're going to call them when you get home, but you're going to use that neighbor as a point of contact. And I want you to say with everything that's in you, say, neighbor, I forgive you. And I let it go. Go to somebody else and say, neighbor, I forgive you. And I let it go. Go to one more person and say, neighbor, I forgive you. And I let it go. Now hold on to that neighbor's hand and tell that neighbor, it's off you now. I'm through now. You can be seated if you can. You can be seated if you can. But if you read the text, the next thing that Israel did was shout. They went around Jericho. I need three people. I don't need but three that recognize it's off of them. Would you just go to dancing right now? Just dance right where you are. No. I don't want an obligatory dance. I don't want you to say we had church because we danced. I want somebody that lets some stuff go to give God praise. One, two, three. Come on. To let some stuff go. Oh, yeah. All right. Really? See? What you have to recognize, the Apostle Paul writes and says that when we don't forgive, we give the devil the advantage, because he knows that God can't work if you have unforgiveness in you. I want you to snatch that advantage back. Look at your neighbor and say, I got the advantage now. Now come on and give him praise if you got this. I got it.
Come on, let's give God a hand praise in this place. Touch about five people and tell them your wait is over. Come on, touch five from y'all on the count to two. One, two, three, four, five. Tell them your wait is over. Tell them it's your season. It's your season of healing. It's your season of deliverance. It's your season of restoration. It's your season of wholeness. It's your season of wellness. I don't see nobody turning in here. Because if you turn around in this house, God will turn some around in your house. If you turn around in this house, he'll turn some around in your pocketbook. Touch five people and tell them, I'm getting ready to get my turn. I don't see nobody turning. Somebody holler back at your boy. Oh, bless him. Come on, touch three people. Tell them, I'm going to get mine. I'm going to get mine. Now give God the best praise you got. I need somebody to give God a praise who shouldn't be here today. I need somebody to give God a praise that you should be dead today. You should be locked up somewhere. Somebody, God stepped in. Ah, somebody! Give your God a praise, not your praise. Touch five people, tell him he's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. Come on, tell him he's a mighty God. Let him know you're looking at a miracle. Tell them you're looking at a miracle. You're looking at a miracle. If I got what I deserve, I'll be graveyard dead on my way to a devil's hell. But somewhere grace and mercy stepped along the way. Tell them you're looking at a miracle. And you think I'm going to come up in here and don't give God no praise? You think I'm going to come? Oh, yeah! Give him a praise and bless him in this house. There's five more people. Tell him he's a mighty God. He's a mighty. He's a mighty. He's a mighty. He's a mighty God. You may be seated. Be seated. Be seated. Let's give God a hand praise for our bishop. The Bishop Marvin L. Wine is in our midst. Come on, clap your hands for our illustrious leader. He is our visionary. He is our leader. Come on, you can do better than that. Stand on your feet and celebrate our bishop. Hallelujah. Total living, it is offering time. Clap your hand. God loves what kind of a giver? What kind of a giver? Then put your hands together, open up your mouth, and make some noise up in this place. Hallelujah. While we're getting ready, we are streaming live on the internet. Let's give our viewers a great big praise and welcome them to the Total to Living Church. Come on, you can do better. Open up your mouth and holler. Holler, holler. I'm going to ask as many who can to follow me with a gift of $100. Get a seed of $100 in your hand. This is good ground. Tell your neighbor, this is good ground. Those who are watching by internet, we have made it easy for you. Just click on your donation button. This is good ground. We feed over 1,200 families consistently every month. Clap your hands. That is not people. That is families. We service over 18 sober living quarters with food and with toiletries. Come on, clap your hands. Tell your neighbor, this is good ground. The ground is fertile. You want to sow in good ground. Get that seed of $100 in your hand. Hallelujah. Let, or close as you can to it. Let no one give tonight less than $25. Hallelujah. Raise your hand if you need an envelope. Hallelujah. Raise your hands high and the usher will tend to you. Hallelujah. Whenever you give, you are saying, God, you are my king. And I come to pay you tribute because you have allowed me to go into the enemy's camp and spoil him. Hallelujah. And you coming to pay God tribute. Thank you, Jesus. Is he a mighty God? I just want to know, is he a mighty God? Is he a mighty God? If God, if God healed anybody of cancer this year, anybody been healed of cancer, then you ought to give God a crazy praise. He's a, tell your name, he's a mighty God. Get that seed in your hand. I am excited. I am so excited about this season of celebration. Our God is a good God. He is worthy to be praised. Thank you, Jesus. Get that gift out. Get ready. When you're ready, stand to your feet. Everyone should be standing. Follow me with that seed of $100 because I'm looking for God to do something 100%. I need 100% breakthrough. I don't want no halfway deliverance. I need to be brought all the way out. Anybody need to be brought all the way I want one of them blessings that is pressed down, running over, shaking together. I want one of them blessings that make folk mad at me. Yeah, you're going to talk about me this year because I'm riding good, I'm living good, I'm smelling good. I wish I had half a church. When you're ready, stand to your feet, stand. Everyone should be standing with something. If you ain't got nothing, look at somebody with an envelope in their hand, just stand on side of them, act like you're with them. Y'all so deep, can't laugh. I worked on that one. You know how we were back in there, man. What you got on it? I got five on it. I got 10. Tell your neighbor, put some down on it. I feel a praise about to break out in this place. Tell your neighbor, you're going to get your miracle tonight. Not tomorrow, not next week, but in the next 30 seconds, God's going to turn something around in your life. God's going to rebuke the divine. I don't see nobody turning up in here. God's going to stir something up. God's going to heal something. Pookie might walk through the door. I wish I had somebody in here. Ray Ray might mess around and get saved. I wish I had me somebody. Ooh, somebody. We want to recognize these distinguished pastors. We want to give God praise for all these wonderful pastors who have come join us. Pastor BeBe is here. Come on, give him a praise. Pastor Stan Collins, Pastor Edwards, Pastor Bishop Clifton Edwards, Pastor Craig, Pastor Sister Hughes. Come on. Give him a praise. Bishop and Lady Darnsberry is here. Come on, clap your hands for him. Come on, you can do better than that. Don't forget the awesome combo of the Blairs is in the house. Come on, clap your hands for them. Holly, listen, you don't miss it. We only got 12 of her CDs left, actually 11, because I'm taking one for myself. Hallelujah. So you want to get the CDs. She's got them right at the table, only 12 left, and God is blessing us. Amen? I want to introduce our speaker. He's our bishop. He's our leader. He is Marvin L. Winans of the Perfecting Church, our great bishop of Perfecting Fellowship International. In my opinion, he is the greatest bishop in the whole wide world. Kind man, holy man. After our summons, come and sing none other in the person of Sister Tamela Mann and her husband here. Come on, clap your hands for the man. Brother David, please stand. Come on, clap your hands for him. Hallelujah. After she has rendered her songs, and the next voice you will hear after her will be our illustrious leader, Bishop Marvin Winans. Let's say amen to Sister Tamela Mann come at this time. Come on, clap your hands for her. Come on, clap your hands for that mic. Come on, clap your hands for her.
One, two. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Let everything help praise the Lord. Oh, you can do better than that. Oh, you can do better than that. He just told you our God is great. He's greatly to be praised. He's great. Hallelujah. To the utmost, he keeps saving. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you for having me, Pastor. And to my pastor, Pastor Blair is my pastor. And to Bishop Winans, but to the best man in the world, my husband. I'm going to sing, but he got to say something to you. Come here, babe. I know.
Who, me? Hello, everybody. Hello. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. We've been married 23 years. That's without any separations. That was supposed to be real big. God is still in the keeping business. Did you hear me? The keeping business? Keeping us together. No matter what, keeping us together, not giving up on each other, but keeping us together. That's the message, one of you pastors. Keeping us together, praise the Lord. Amen. I didn't bring any product. I'm sorry. The master plan is in stores. They just tell me I have to say these things. So if you don't have it, Walmart, Target, iTunes, those places have it. How many of y'all have the joy of the Lord? I need you to put your hands together with me. And we're going to do joy of the Lord. Come on, put your hands together if you got the joy of the Lord. Sing it if you know it. When my problems come knocking at me, full of glory, joy unspeakable. Tears away, lift your hand and say, weeping may endure for a night. Joy. How many of y'all know joy is coming? Yes, it is. The world can't take it. Do you have a joy full of glory? I've got the joy of the Lord. The world can't take it. You can have a joy, 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 so much joy. The world can't take it away. Thank you for my joy, Lord. Don't take it, don't take it, don't take it. Don't take it, don't take it, don't take it. Whatever you do, Lord, give me back my joy. Hallelujah. Oh, bless your name, Jesus. He's worthy, yes, he is. How many of y'all know he has the master plan? I'ma sing this for Bishop. Hallelujah. Thank you for the master plan. Woo!
Oh yeah. Oh my, my. You may be wondering
are you gonna fix it? Oh Lord, with nowhere to turn. Yeah. With the weight, oh Lord, so much weight on your shoulder, and it seems nobody cares. Hold on, no, no, no. God's got the answer. Yes, He does. But you don't have to worry. No, 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 no. God's got the master plan. Yes, He does. Oh, the Father knows what's best for you. Yes, He does. Whatever it is, God's got it. You've been searching. He has the answer right there. My God has everything you need. He has everything you want. I tell you to try Him. I tell you to reach out for Him. He's knocking. He's knocking at the door of your heart. He's our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, we'll see. How great. How great is our God. Help me. How great is our God. Sing with me. How great, no, oh, we'll see, how great is our God, I just love that part. How great is our God, my God, my God, my God.
Come on and give God praise, everybody. Father, it is the entrance of thy word that bringeth light and life, and tonight we pray that the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ would shine bright as always. May the people be blessed by thee and never impressed by me. Calls through the revelation of thy word these thy people to see you more clearly, to love you more dearly, and to follow you more nearly. And now, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. And every glad heart said amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Tonight we do honor the Lord and we thank God for his favor and for his kindness. How great is our God. He's great and he's greatly to be praised. I am so delighted to be here at Total Deliverance tonight. And there is meaning in the name. Hallelujah. No matter how you came in here, you can leave here totally delivered. I have some product there, and I'm not. Okay, I guess I need to obey this. Wow. You know, I have a little church there in Detroit, and I try to preach to them because I'm sincere about what I do. And a few weeks ago, we preached the message because I think the church is unaware of its power. And we've allowed the world to dictate to us who we are and what we're to be doing. And this message came as a clarion call. It's entitled, Wake Up to Glory. Jesus took Peter, James, and John into the mountain. And Luke's account of this says that when they got up to the mountain, Peter, James, and John went up to the mountain with Jesus, and Jesus was transfigured. And Moses and Elijah appeared with him on that mountain. And while that was going on, Peter, James, and John were asleep. It's bad to be asleep while God is doing some transformation in your life. But if you're going to go to sleep, sleep on the mountain. All right, let's tell somebody, wake up to glory. This is very important. And this is a DVD. And what I try to teach people is faith not only has to be in your heart, it has to be in your mouth. And the language of faith. Somebody need this, I'm going to give this to somebody. Your hand went up, sir. Come on, quickly. Run down here. He was the first one. Hand went up. The language of faith. You need to learn how to say it in spite of how you see it. The language of faith. Somebody over here. Here's the come on, sweetheart. The young, behind you. Yes, that was the first hand. I said, y'all got to get quick on the draw. Put your shoes on, baby, and come on. She done got comfortable here. That's all right. This stuff, shoes didn't make it. She didn't make the shoes. It's better to give. That's the subject. And so there are more out there, and I'm going to move on because I don't want to overstay my stay here. I am delighted. I have been happy since I have met the visionary and his wife And I want to say that you have a man of God that loves the vision. And we're here tonight to lift up his hands. Would you give God praise for Pastor and First Lady Avery Austin? Come on and give God praise. I need everybody standing to your feet. If you have legs, prove it. And get up and give God praise. Come on, open your mouth and give God praise. Let him know that you appreciate what God is doing. It is very easy to quit. It's very easy to quit and to become discouraged to the point that all you care about is you and yours. But if you place God's vision first, then God will certainly give you good measure, pressed down, shaken together. So happy to see Pastor Daryl Blair and First Lady B. I know you've been blessed. He can preach, can't he? And his wife can sing, can't she? And to y'all didn't know Cora could sing like that, didn't you? I love Brother David and Sister Tamela Mann. They are so humble and so everyday people. And it means something to have options and to exercise one of humility. All right. Thank you so much for having me here today. Let's go to work. I want to take you to Exodus, the 40th chapter. And I want to read into your hearing the 9th through the 15th verse. And then we will go to 2 Samuel, the 8th chapter. And the 11th verse. Okay? Just turn it up just a little bit and leave it. You can go get your Bibles because I can handle it from here. Exodus. Thank you. That's it. Right there. That's it. Exodus 40 and 9. Yes, if one stand, we all stand. And we're going to read that and then we're going to go to 2 Samuel, the 8th chapter and the 11th verse. If you have Exodus 40 and 9, indicate by shouting amen.
Amen.
Hear the beginning of the reading of God's word. And thou shalt take the anointing oil and anoint the tabernacle. And all that is therein, and shalt hallow it, and all the vessels thereof, and it shall be holy. And thou shalt anoint the altar of the burnt offering, and all his vessels, and sanctify the altar. And it shall be an altar most holy. And thou shalt anoint the laver and his foot and sanctify it. And thou shalt bring Aaron and his sons unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation and wash them with water. And thou shalt put upon Aaron the holy garments and anoint him and sanctify him, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office. And thou shalt bring his sons and clothe them with coats. And thou shalt anoint them as thou didst anoint their father. that they may minister unto me in the priest's office, for their anointing shall surely be an everlasting priesthood throughout their generations. And the people of God said, amen. 2 Samuel 8 and 11, which also King David did dedicate unto the Lord with the silver and gold that he had dedicated of all nations which he subdued. Let's read that one again. Which also King David did dedicate unto the Lord with the silver and gold that he had dedicated of all nations which he subdued. So, Father, scriptures, our subject tonight, look your neighbor in the eye and say, neighbor, anoint what you've been through. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercies never ceasing, call for songs of highest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. I like hymns. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy grace I've come, and by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He who rescued me from danger. Interposed his precious blood. Take it to E flat. This is the verse I like. It says, daily. No. You need E flat? Okay. It says, oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a feather, tie my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. But here's my heart. Take and seal it to thy courts above. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. I don't know why I don't want to leave the God I love. No, I'm going to. Which also King David did dedicate unto the Lord with the silver and gold that he had dedicated of all nations which he subdued. Anoint what I've been through. whether we can see it or not, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his right hand. And the Lord spoke to me one day and said, if I ordered the steps, I ordered the fall. If we had the control over our own lives, we would have charted our course differently. We would have averted and circumvented some of the arrows and pains and woes that we've experienced. And that's where your faith comes in, because you must believe that God is in control. I'm going to preach in a moment. After receiving Jesus, we must be renewed in our mind. Jeremiah had to come to grips with that, because he made the decision to obey God at a very young age. As a matter of fact, his reasoning for not doing what God had called him to do had everything to do with his age. He was telling God, I can't do this because I'm too young. I don't have enough experience. And God, as only God can, told him, Jerry, don't say any more to me that you are a child, because I'm well aware of your limitations. I know your abilities, and I understand your weaknesses. Just as a side note, I've discovered that God is not looking for those that have ability as much as he's looking for those who have availability. And he said, say no more that you are a child, because before you were formed in your mother's belly, I already knew you. Think about that, it'll hit you later. Before you came out, I had already had an ordination service, and I sanctified you to be a prophet to the nation. I'm going to put my word in your mouth. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And you are going to prophesy to nations. You're going to tear down and you're going to build up. You're going to supplant, you're going to plant. But it was also Jeremiah that said, God, you deceived me, because I didn't know that saying yes would cause so much frustration. I didn't know that you could do everything God told you to do and folks still not like you. Yeah. Jerry said, I didn't know that I could be anointed for a people, and the people I'm anointed for hate me. God directs your steps. God orders your ways. And all he needs you to do is submit to his plan. Our text. You have to understand, and I'm not going to preach long, really, I'm not going to preach long. Pastor Blair has to get on a plane, and I want to finish the message before they leave. The idea of church is all God's. People act as if church gets on their nerves. I've never seen church folk not wanting to spend time in church. Folk to do football, the game may not start at 4, but they start tailgating in the morning. I don't hear nobody talking to me. You don't hear folks in the club talking about I pressed my way to get here. You don't hear folks in the bar talking about, yeah, pray that I come back next week because I've been tough. The only place you hear that kind of language is in church. But church, I'm trying to stay focused here and do a bishop message, you know, not be evangelist whining. You see, there's a different caller. The church is God's idea. In our text, he talks about the tabernacle of the congregation. That literally means the tabernacle or the place of meeting. That this is where the people of God come by divine direction to hear what thus saith the Lord. And they're in no hurry to leave, because in the presence of the Lord is fullness of joy, and at his right hand are pleasures evermore. So you can tell when your love of God or love for God begins to wane, to denigrate, to evaporate, to disappear, because you don't like hanging out where God is. See, I need some church folk that love church. That was real weak. I'll give you another opportunity later on in the message. To understand that everything I need is locked up in God. And all I need from God is a word from God. And he speaks on a corporate level at his house. Y'all really gonna make me work here, huh? He speaks at his house. He can talk anywhere because he's everywhere. But he shows up at a plot, a lot, territory that has been hallowed or sanctified or dedicated for him. Hey, Lord, have mercy. I understand. I understand in today's modern theological, philosophical meanderings that we don't have churches now. We have multi-purpose buildings. They don't even look like churches. They don't have symbols. They don't have things that remind you of church. Because you could have church there one day and a circus there the next. I ain't mad at nobody. I'm just trying to preach the text here. God said, I want you to have a particular place that is used for my purpose. If you're to read the 25th chapter of Exodus, you understand that God began to call for things because he wanted to have a place. You know how it is. You just want your place. Some place that you can call home. Doesn't have to be fancy. Not trying to keep up with the Joneses. But it suits me. It fits me. When I turn the key, it's mine. I don't have to try to impress anybody. The seat may have a dip in it from the way I sit in it. But it's my seat. You don't like my house? Leave. You don't like my color scheme? Bye. That's what God said. God said, I have a spot that I want for me. And I'm going to dictate its particulars. I'm going to tell you what I want in there. Don't have to have a whole lot of furniture. I just want a little desk, a little table. Shoe bread. Lord have mercy. Let me stay focused here. You go ahead and read the 25th chapter of Exodus. But here in our text, let me deal with my text here. Here in our text, God has told Moses what to do. And he says that this is my house. And everything in my house has to be anointed. Somebody holler back at me, anointed. There's 3 points I want to make and then I'm going to finish. The first point is that you must hallow the things of the tabernacle. In other words, you have to make it holy. Touch somebody and say, this is holy ground. Yeah, yeah. So there has to be a reverence for the things of God. Yeah, this is not just space. This is not a multi-purpose room. This is a tabernacle of meeting. So your kids can't just run through here and play football and act like, well, it's just a... No, it's not just. Deliverance has to take place. Did y'all want me to preach this or not? I don't know. We do all sorts of things in the tabernacle and wonder why we don't see the miracles. It's because we have very little reverence for the house of God. It's not about, well, I can wear whatever I wear. No, not at the house. You shouldn't come to the house of God looking like you're on your way to a ball game. I don't hear nobody talking to me. All right, maybe this is too strict. One young man came to me one time and said, Pastor, when we gonna have a come as you are service? I said, we had that every Sunday. I ain't trying to put nobody out. You can do what you want in your church. I'm just talking about me. Men sitting in church with hats on, baseball caps, turned around backwards. I ain't talking about the ones coming off the street. I'm talking about the one that's been here. How in the world do you expect the world to respect the house of God? And you don't respect that. I'm just trying to prove. Because the pastor asked me to dedicate this. Ladies. You shouldn't dress like that nowhere. And say you're saved. But especially in the house. Lean on somebody, say, cover that up, cover it up, cover it up. Because we're going into the house of the Lord. And you have to make it holy. That's the reason. And let me, I'm really a nice guy. I ain't trying to put nobody out. I'm just trying to set the stage for total deliverance. Ain't nobody mad because you got curves. This is the house. They came to Jesus and said, Jesus, how shall we pray? He said, when you pray, you shall say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed would be thy name. That's the reason I don't let folk use the name of Jesus around me. Just say Jesus. Cuss and say Jesus. Talk about Jesus. Just say, oh, Christ. No, you can't say that. Because you should make that name holy. One of the reasons in Jewish culture they have so many names for God is because they didn't call him at his most holy name. So they had other names. that sort of lesson, because when you said Adonai, then it means you have to say that in a place of holiness and reverence. We look at a ball game and say, oh, Jesus, he struck out. Jesus, he struck out. Tell somebody, make it holy, make it holy. You should reverence when you walk through that door. I don't care what it was before you got here. Tonight, it becomes holy. And so you make it holy. All right, that's my first point. He said, hallow the things of the tabernacle. Thou shalt take the anointing oil and anoint the tabernacle and all that is therein, and shalt hallow it and all of the vessels therein. Everything about the house, the fan, the lights, the cameras and the action, has to be hallowed. Say amen. The second thing is that he has to anoint the priest of the tabernacle. Lord, help me here. The priesthood has to reverence the call. That when you come to minister, you have to recognize what you're doing. In Chronicles, the Bible says that the priests, the Levites, the trumpeters, and the singers, that when they were all one, then the glory of the Lord filled the house. So that the priests were not able to minister by reason of the cloud. When you recognize that I'm not just singing a solo, or it's not just my choir that's singing this Sunday, or I'm not just playing the organ or the bass or the drums, but everything I do should be done with the understanding that I'm operating under the anointing of the Holy Ghost. We've become too playful with church and with the anointing. That we don't recognize that we are in spiritual warfare. And that everything we do, the Bible says that no flesh should glory in his presence. I don't want me to shine. I want the anointing of the Holy Ghost. So as I mount the roster, as I preach, as I sing, whatever I'm doing, I must understand I do it under the anointing, and I have to be anointed to do it. Lift your hands and say, Lord, anoint me to do it. From those that give water, to those that give announcements, you have to do so when it's in the tabernacle. Lord, have mercy. I said when it's in the tabernacle, you have to learn how to do it under the anointing. And the anointing is not in competition with the anointing. So when you stand here, you're not trying to out-sing anybody. You're not trying to out-preach anyone. You're not trying to outplay, out-direct, out-cook, out-anything when it comes to the sanctuary. You recognize that we are in one body, each member in particular, and we work together so that God could have free course. That his house would be a house of prayer and a house of peace. Lean on somebody and say, we're on the same team. When we come into the house of the Lord, we have to walk light. We got to pray.
before we get here, on our way here, after we arrive here. I've been preaching for more years than I care to mention. I've been pastoring for 22 years, and I still go to 6 a.m. prayer. The reason I go to 6 a.m. prayer on Sunday mornings is because I don't want to just talk. I want to preach. I don't want to just sound eloquent. I want to touch somebody that's going through something. And the only way for me to minister that way, I have to be in touch with the master. Because it's not about me. It's about him, because he knows exactly what you need. Tell somebody, we on the same team. You have to hallow or make holy the things of the tabernacle. And then the priests have to be anointed in the tabernacle. Let me close with my last point. And you have to tell God, anoint my past. I know that may sound a little paradoxical, for a lot of us are trying to run from our past. We're trying to forget our past. And yet somehow our past stays with us. Lean on somebody and tell them, I want God to anoint my past. Let me deal with this just for a moment. To understand who God is, when God called Moses, Moses recognized that he had a sordid past. And as God is anointing him for his future, Moses reminds God, am I boring you? I hope I'm not boring. I'm coming down the hill now. God is trying to anoint Moses' future. And Moses brings up his past. And says, Lord, there's some people in Egypt that remember me. And they recognize what I did before I left. I never served a sentence for killing that Egyptian. I left before word got to the court. I'm happy where I am. Got a wife and two kids. Successful business. I don't need the drama. But since I know this is you and you're telling me to go back to Egypt, I recognize that I cannot go back as a politician. I can't even go back as the son of Pharaoh. I can't even go back as a good Hebrew. So I need some authority. I need to operate under your authority. So Lord, whom shall I say sent me? And God said, when you get there, tell them that I am sent you. Tell them not the I was, not the I will be, but tell them that I am sent you. And he said, Lord, what's your last name? He said, well, I'm going to give you my first, middle, and last. I am that I am. This is very important. It is important because when Jesus shows up, he said, "The thief cometh not but for to steal, to kill, and to destroy." He says, "But I am come." Paul says it this way: Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. John on the Isle of Patmos receives a revelation and an epiphany of God. And he says, "Who are you?" And Jesus says, "I am he which was, which is, and which is to come." Now, he never has to move from where he is, but he extends himself in every tense of your life. Would y'all just pray with me for a moment? Do I have anybody that believes they've been called by God? Raise your hand if you feel like I've been called by God. How many feel that you've been called according to his purpose? All right. To understand this means, Lord, I thank you, that what this means is, if God has called me, then he had to know me before I got here. And if he knew me before I got here, he had to be watching over me when I was there. And he had to understand everything that I was doing wrong when I was there. And the reason he didn't let it overwhelm me or take me out, the reason I didn't die in it, is because he knew I would get hit. So there had to be a grace when I was there, because it wasn't luck that got me here. It was God standing right here but working over there, because only God can walk into your past. I'm getting ready to preach here. Stands here understanding that you are without God. You don't have a knowledge of his holiness. And God allowed you to get in some stuff. Some of the things that we got into, we're ashamed of. And we don't want anybody to know. Hold on a second, I just warming up here. We don't want anyone to know what we've been through, because it doesn't fit our Christian profile. So we try to hide things because we don't want to ruin the opinion that folks have of us. And so when we run into people that knew us when, we duck in the mall. Oh Lord, because we don't want folk to remind folk of who we used to be. Yes. But I want you to understand something. God wants to anoint your path. I want to talk to a few folks for the next 5 minutes. Tell somebody, say, neighbor, you really don't know what I've been through. There are things that I'm ashamed of. But when I come into a holy place, all is known and all is forgiven. I just need somebody to help me here. Tell your neighbor, all is known and all is forgiven. Hey, God knew. Lord, have mercy. I said, God knew. He knew where he found me. And he knew what he brought me out of. And I don't glorify sin. But tell somebody, I'm through running away from my past. Because if God delivered you here tonight, tell somebody, I'm free. And whoever the Son sets free is free. And they got the deed to go along with it. Tell somebody, I'm owning my freedom here. Y'all gonna catch it later on. I gotta move on. And so when we step into the hallowed place, then we don't do so in a farce. We don't do so in pretense. We don't do so as a phony or as a hypocrite. See, that word hypocrite means to play act. We don't come in the house of God acting like we say. Lord, have mercy. See, Jesus went to one of those meetings. And in the 18th chapter of Luke, the Bible says that Jesus said there was two men that walked into the temple. And one walked in and said, you know, Lord, I want to thank you that I really want to thank you for me. I'm happy that I'm not like that That sin over there. I fast twice in the week. I pay tithes of all that I possess. I honor my mother and father. I keep the law. I just want to thank you that I'm so wonderful. And Jesus said there was a fella over in the corner that wouldn't so much as lift up his head, but had such reverence and respect for God that he smote himself in the chest and said, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus said, that man went away justified. The other fellow went like he came. What I'm telling you is when you step into the place of his holiness, the priest had to wash up every time they came in. Because no matter how good you think you are, you're not holy enough to stand before God. That same Jeremiah said, all of your righteousness is nothing like, it's just like a heap of filthy rags. So when you come in, you have to redress. You have to tell God, wash me. Lord, have mercy. I haven't been out smoking, drinking, cussing around, acting ugly, haven't been fornicating, haven't been whoremongering, haven't been committing adultery, but God, wash me. Because I'm coming into a place that has been dedicated to your holiness. And I dare not stand in your presence acting like you're not a holy God. And I need you to wash me again. Tell your neighbor, get washed again. What God will do, and come on and help me now. What God will do is take your past and anoint it so things that you used to be ashamed of now become a point of power. In other words, you can look at that person and say, baby, I know what you're struggling with. You might be able to hide with folk that haven't been there, but come here and let me tell you, I know what's on your back. I know that demon you're fighting with, because he had the victory over me. But I came into the house of the Lord, and God anointed my past. Oh, Lord. So now, when I think of where he brought me from, I don't cry. I find joy. Because if I hadn't gone through that, then I would not be able to deliver somebody else. But if God, oh Lord, I said if God brought me through it, shake somebody's hand and say, if he delivered me, then he can deliver you. Now pull him and say, come on out. Ah, come on out. Come on and give him praise. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Say yes. Yeah. Yeah. David. Oh Lord. David is getting ready to anoint some things. Oh yes. David had pre-dedication ceremonies, because he knew that he couldn't build the house, but he did the architectural work. But God told him, I can't let you build it, because you're a man of war, and my house is a house of peace. David said, that's all right. I'm not going to get upset with your decision, but I'm going to prepare everything that has to go in the house. Oh, Lord, what David was doing, every time he had a war and got the bounty or the booty from the war, he said, I got to take out stuff and I got to dedicate it to the house of God. Every victory, oh Lord, every victory that God gave him, he anointed it and said, I've got me something, but I got to put God's house. Lord have mercy. I know I may not be talking to but a few folk here, but let me preach to my hearer. Every time God gives you something, you have to learn how to sanctify it. In other words, you got to learn how to pull it apart. Tell somebody, that's what the tithe is about. It's about recognizing every time God puts something in my hand, I got to sanctify what belongs to him. I gotta take my stuff out of his stuff. I gotta give him his stuff, because it is in him that I live, and it's in him that I move, and it's in him that I have my being. And if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, I wouldn't have been able to do what I did. God anointed me when I didn't even know what the anointing was. Every victory that God gave me, everything that God allowed me to overcome, he's allowed me to go through it for this time. And I have to learn how to dedicate everything I am. I feel like preaching now. Touch your neighbors and neighbor. Everything I am, I gotta give it to God. Everything, I feel like preaching. Everything, everything that God gave me, I gotta learn how to dedicate it to him. Say yes, say yes, yeah. That's the reason David
said if you delight yourself also in the Lord, he'll give you the desire of your heart. That word delight means to become pliable. In other words, I become putty in the hand of God. And God, whatever you want to make me is all right with me. And that's the reason everything about me has to recognize God. I will bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is in me. Got to bless his name. Ah, yes. Say yeah. My mind got to bless him. My heart got to bless him. My spleen got to bless him. My desires got to bless him. My ambitions got to bless him. Say yeah. Yeah. Somebody, I feel the preacher all on me. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I've been sent here. You can stop rolling your eyes, cause I ain't going nowhere. You might as well like me, because I've been anointed for this. Oh, Lord, yeah, oh, yes, I've been anointed to do this. He shows up, and there's a fight going on. He so happens to hear a giant in the valley talking about, send me your best man, and if he killed me, we'll serve you. But if I kill him, you've got to serve us. David is sitting there waiting for somebody to accept the challenge. And I'm finishing my message. When nobody goes, he says, I'll go. His brothers get upset with him. Lean on your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm getting ready to do what God called me to do. Y'all ain't saying it like I'm preaching it. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm fixing to do what God called me to do. Look at him and say, now neighbor, don't get mad. Maybe I'll preach over here. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm getting ready to do what God called me to do. Now don't get mad. You might think I'm too young, but I'm getting ready to do it. You might think I'm too short. You might think I'm too poor. You might think I'm too illiterate. But tell them I'm getting ready to do it. Why? What qualifies you to do what God called me to do? Well, tell somebody I got a testimony, and I'm getting ready to pull out my slingshot and hit you with my testimony. Because if God is the same yesterday, hey, if God was able to keep me in all that I was doing, he's still able. Yeah, ah, yes, say yeah, shout yeah, ah, yes, I need somebody to give him praise. Come on, just wave your hand. Ah, yeah, no, 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 no. David, I'm through. David goes into the valley. The giant sees him and thinks he's a joke. Do I have somebody that's getting ready to dedicate themselves to God? Look at somebody and tell them, say, I ain't no joke. Everyone stand to your feet. Lord, prepare me.
be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. And with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. Lord, Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life. Lord, I offer my life to you. Everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Oh, Lord, I offer you my surrender. Lift those hands, everybody. I surrender. To thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. If you mean it, say, I surrender. Sing it. If you plan on dedicating yourself to him tonight, sing it. Open your mouth. All to thee. Sing it. Open your mouth and sing.
Blessed Savior.
Tell him I surrender. Lift those hands, lift them up. Lift those hands. Lift those hands. Father, in the name of Jesus, lift those hands. We anoint this altar. We anoint this place. We give you praise for your presence. We give you praise for what you will do here. We anoint this place. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Every instrument, every article, we anoint every minister in the name of Jesus. Every auxiliary in the name of Jesus. We give you praise for what you will do, for demons being cast out, for the sick being healed, for miracles being performed. Hallelujah. For prosperity in this house.
Anoint every man in the name of Jesus. Every father and every mother. The glory of God be in this house. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And now, Lord. In the name of Jesus, let them be seen differently. In this area, the anointing of God. Father, I pray every pastor, every bishop, every elder, every person here would leave understanding that they are dedicated to God, and God will anoint what you've been through. I feel the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I just need somebody to give God praise.
Everybody said yes. Come on, sing it. Say yes.
Yeah.
Y'all not singing it like you mean. The anointing. Yes, Lord. Open your mouth. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, 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 hey. Maya la 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 la.
Known me since maybe I was 12 years old. She's younger than me. But I guess I was considered a very strange, maybe around 12 or 13 years old. It was the first time I went to her father's church. Her father was a great preacher, pastor there in the city. And I guess I was considered, you can be seated just for a moment. We're getting ready to go home. Getting ready to sow a seed, so I don't want anybody walking. Thank you. I guess I was considered a strange person. Because I loved church. And I say this because I could hear the Spirit saying this to me. There was a time for about, I'm going to be nice and say about 2 years. Might have been three. No, it was more than one. Where every day they fooled around because I was the minister of music and the youth leader. I was around 18 when I had that responsibility. Every day I would go to the church. Didn't have nothing to do with church. I would ride the bus and go to the church and open the door and go in, pray, or just sit there for at least 2 years every day. Had nothing to do with my responsibility. Had everything to do with how I wanted to be in the presence of God. I sense here that some of you need to make this church a part of your day. I don't know. You may not have a key. You don't have to bug the pastor for a key. But if you don't do anything but just come and sit in the parking lot and pray for 15 minutes. Or when the doors open, just come in and pray, sit, read your Bible. Because this is the tabernacle of congregation. And a lot of times people don't understand that just sitting in the presence of God is purpose for inspiration. I've written a lot of songs, and some of them just came because I was sitting in the church just thinking on God. And so this is not just a church or an auditorium. It's not an auditorium, it's a sanctuary. It is a place that has been hallowed. Anointing fall on me. Let me say this. When the Lord deals with me, I sing a lot. You know, my church is used to it because that's just how he deal with me. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me. Anointing fall on me. Everybody whisper, everybody say, anointing fall on me. Anointing fall on me. Say it like you mean. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me. Yeah. Anointing. Anointing fall. I'm believing. Anointing, oh Lord. Let the power, let it fall. Would you say that? The Lord. Just say that. I don't want to bother you, but just say that one time. Everybody say, I know we're getting ready to go, but just bask in a moment.
Well.
Let the power, the Holy Ghost, fall on
me.
Anointing. I'm going to give a sacrifice of $500. I want at least 100 people to share an offering of $50. I need those persons that say, Pastor, I know you've been giving. This is not a giving or a money raising venture. I want you to understand. I want those 100 people quickly to stand with an offering of $50. Just stand quickly. Get it.
Anointing. Well, fall on. Well, la, 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 la. Anointing. Fall. Let the power of the
Holy Ghost fall on me. Yeah, anointing. Yeah, anointing. Fall on me. Fall on me, yeah. Let the power of the Holy Ghost, oh, fall on me. Anointing.
Father, I believe your word. There's 100 people that need to share, that need to sow that seed. In Jesus' name, I believe it so. I rebuke the enemy of doubt. And I command those that believe God that they're walking into a holy season. Yes, Lord. In Jesus' name, those persons that are going to come, just come right now and put it in my hand. And I'm going to count one. Come on, give God praise. Everybody say anointing. Anointing. I need some more to come that are sowing. I'm going to get everybody. I'm going to get everybody. We're going to receive everything. But those, there are 100 people here that need to share $50. Come on, come on. Anointing, anointing, fall on me. I need 9 people. I need 34 people. We need 34 people for that 100. I know you're here. Just those that are going to sow $50. 17, 18, 18. Come on, I need somebody to praise God. This ain't a spectator sport. Anointing. I have 19. I need 6 more to make this 25. So I need those 6 people. Then I'll start with my last 25. I don't do numbers. I don't do all that. I just obey God. And when I'm in the flow of God, I can stay here all night. Don't make me no difference. 20. I need 5 to make this 25. 5 more people that say I'm going to sow $50. Into this, to this night, to the revelation that God has given, very quickly. very quickly. Hallelujah. I need to make this 25. I need somebody to say, anointing, anointing. Thank you, Brother Knight. God bless you. 21, 22. Thank you so much, sir. 21. Four more for this to be 25, and then I'll start my last 24.
Let the power.
That's okay. You need it. Hallelujah. 22. 23. 24. All right, come on, give God praise. All right, stay right there. This is the last 25. I need 25 people. 1, 2, 3. I need somebody to give God praise. Come on.